Good morning, all of you. This is Dr. Krishna, and today we are going to see a ratio analysis. I think last week we have started the class ratio analysis. In that ratio analysis, we have seen operating cycle. In that operating cycle, how the debitors, creditors will come up, how cash would be generated and paid to creditors. We have seen in the operating cycle, and in the ratio analysis, I think last week we have seen financial ratios, that is liquidity, leverage, that is short-term solvency and long-term solvency ratios. And this week we are going to see turnover ratios. This week, we are going to see the turnover ratios and profitability ratios. So that is the remaining ratios that we need to cover in this session. So last week, I think the short-term solvency ratio, current ratio, quick ratio, examples, debt equity ratio, I think interest coverage ratio, example, liquidity leverage ratio calculations, all those things we have done in the last week. And this week we are going to see activity and our turnover ratio. Activity means the a company have a different activities in their day-to-day operations, the bringing the raw material, convert them into finished goods and sell them to customers on credit basis. So debtors will come from the debtors, bills must be received, and that bills must be converted into cash, and that cash must be paid to the supplier. So like that, there are different activities that have been taking place in our business day to day. So we'll see how this activity or turnover ratios would be calculated and interpretation, how it would be done. And activity turnover ratios, activity or turnover ratios, both are same. It measures the efficiency and effectiveness of the business resources of assets or assets. We can say that how effectively and efficiently you're utilizing the current assets in the business. It calculates, if you see, it calculates the speed with the various activities, speed of various activities, how speed you are bringing the raw material and converting, how speed your stock is being, raw material stock is been converted into finished goods, and how speed the finished goods is been converted into sales, and how speed the sales can be converted into cash, and how speed the cash is been paid to supplier, and how much speed you are bringing the raw material. So like that, there are some speed of activities that are been calculated under activity or turnover ratios. And if you see this, assets on which funds are being blocked up or get converted into sales. Say for example, funds may be blocked. Say you are bringing the raw material from the supplier. So there is no proper production facilities. So that raw material can be converted into finished goods in a late, it consumes the time because you don't have sufficient labor, you don't have sufficient machinery. So in that case, your raw material may be stuck with the manufacturing process, so that so there is no manufacturing means there is no finished product. If there is no finished product means there is no sales in the market. If there is no sales in the market, there is no cash conversion in the market. So there is no payment to the supplier. So like this, every activity will get struck turnover. So that's why assets on which funds are being blocked and get converted into sales is being called activity or turnover. And there are many ratios to calculate in this. One is that stock turnover ratio. Stock turnover ratio means inventory turnover ratio, STR, or stock turnover ratio. So it indicates that, if you see this, it indicates that number of times the stock has been converted into sales. Just now I told you how many times you are bringing the raw material and converted them into finished goods and sales. How many times you are bringing, the higher the times you are bringing, the more the times you are bringing the raw material and converted into sales, and the better the organization performance, the better the organization performance. So effective utilization of resources can be taken place. So stock turnover ratio can be calculated with this COGS by average stock. COGS means cost of goods sold. Cost of goods sold by average stock. What is this cost of goods sold? A cost of goods sold is equals opening stock of the raw material and purchases, any purchases are there, previous year closing stock will become opening stock of this year. So that is one, and new purchases of this year and direct expenses which are used to convert the raw material into finished goods at a factory, that is a direct expenses, and a closing stock, whatever the remaining stock at the end of the year. So this is what the formula for calculating the cost of goods sold. So average stock means opening stock and closing stock by two. So these are the numerator and denominator. Numerator is the cost of goods sold, denominator is as average stock. So as there is no opening stock or closing stock, then total stock may be taken as a average stock. So ideal turnover ratio, ideal stock turnover ratio is that 10 to 12 times, means in a year, company should bring 12 times of raw material and convert it into cash and sell in the market. So 12 times you are bringing the raw material from the supplier based on your capacity. So the higher the times, the better the company. The higher the times, the better the company. That is a stock turnover ratio. If you see the stock turnover ratio, cost of goods sold 2009, 10, 11, 12, like this, up to 2013-14, there is a cost of goods sold. This is the average inventory. And inventory turnover ratio, if you see, 2009 and 10, 5.6, 7.96, 6.9, 7.13, like this. So the there are fluctuations a year. There are stock turnover ratio is fluctuating from 1 year. It is more, another year it is less. More or less, it is making pi to on an average minimum 5.97 to maximum 7.13. So what is the median ideal stock turnover ratio? 12 times. 12 times, 10 to 12 times. But here the company is doing inventory turnover 5.97 times or 6 times, maximum 7 times. But it is less only, but it is it has to be the turnover, stock turnover should be 10 to 12 times must be converted into sales. So that is what we can say that we can give the interpretation. The higher the stock turnover ratio, the better the company which is using effectively. So that like this, we can have a graph on this. First 2 years, it is less. And next 3 years, it is okay. Next 2 years, the company is doing well. You have to find the reasons. First 2 years, why the stock turnover ratio is less. So like this, we can have. And debtors turnover ratio. I already told you, debtors turnover ratio means debtors turnover ratio. I already told you that whatever the finished goods we are selling to the customers on credit basis. On credit basis, customers will be called as a debtors. So it expresses the relationship between the debtors and sales. How much sales you are doing and how many customers are buying on a credit basis. That is what it is found that by dividing the credit sales by average debtors, debtors turnover ratio indicates the number of times debtors turnover each year. The higher the debtors turnover, higher the debtors turnover means higher the sales. So debtors turnover ratio can be calculated like this. Net credit sales, I already told you, because of credit sales only debtors will come up. So net credit sales by average debtors means net credit sales means numerator can be calculated sales minus sales returns. After selling the goods to the customers, there are some difficult damages or some sales, whatever we did may come back from the customers because of damage or because of less quality, some goods may come up. So that returns on sales may be adjusted with the sales. So that's what net credit sales is equal sales minus sales returns. So average debtors is equals opening stock plus closing stock by debtors. If there are no credit sales information, then total sales can be considered as a credit sales. If no opening stock debtors are, total debtors are considered to be average debtors. So that is what you should remember this. So ideal debtors turnover ratio is 6 to 10 times. Because in your total sales, debtors portion must be 6 to 10 times. 6 to 10 times. Higher the ratio, are higher than the previous year. this debtors always should be higher, so that sales would be higher. So that's why this is what the debtors turnover ratio. If you see the company's 5 years debtors turnover ratio, it is there 2009-10 4.79 and 5.92. It's keep on increasing. It's a good sign. Debtors turnover is always keep on increasing means their sales turnover is good. Their sales turnover, the sales is good in the market. So always debtors turnover ratio. So debtors turnover ratio is 4.7 times in the year 2010. It is increased to 4.97 times and keep on increasing every year. And it reached to 7.25%. So company is doing good in terms of sales, in terms of debtors, in terms of debtors. So it is good sign. It is good sign for the company. It is increasing trend debtors turnover ratio. So their sales have been increasing year by year. It is a good sign for the company. So like this, we can interpret. One more thing is that creditors turnover ratio. Creditors turnover ratio means our accounts payable ratio. To who are the creditors? Creditors means the supplier who supplies the material to us on credit basis. On credit basis. So it measures average number of times a company pays its creditors over a accounting period. How many times you are paying the amount to the creditors like suppliers and how many times you are bringing the raw materials. The higher the times you are paying, the better the payment to the suppliers. Okay. The number of times you are paying means number of times you are bringing the raw material and able to convert them into sales and you are paying again to the supplier, again you are bringing the raw material. It's a continuous process. So the more the times you are paying, the more the times you are bringing the raw material means your turnover is good. Creditors turnover is good. So it indicates that it expresses the relationship between the creditors and purchasers. I already told you creditors will come because of the credit purchases of the raw material. So creditors turnover ratio is equals net credit purchases by average creditor. Net credit purchases can be calculated like purchases minus purchase returns. After purchasing some damages, some goods may be returned to supplier, that returns may be deducted from the purchases. So average debtors can be calculated and credit purchases can be calculated with the purchase minus purchase returns. Whereas a denominator, that is average creditors can be calculated by taking the opening and closing stock of creditors by 2. If the total purchases may be considered when credit purchases are not given, that is there, you should remember that if credit purchases are not there, and total purchases can be considered as a credit purchases. One more thing is that total creditors may be considered including bills payable if opening closing stock are not given. If opening closing stock of creditors is not given, and total creditors may be considered including bills payable because we have to pay the bills to the supplier. So bills payable can be considered if no opening closing creditors data is not given. So that is what information. If you see this accounts payable to our turnover ratio, a company, here I have given one example here. A company reported annual purchases on credit of 123,555 and purchase returns, this is $10,000 during the year ended 31st 2007. Accounts payable at the beginning and end of the year is 12,555 and 25,121. This is accounts payable beginning and opening. Accounts payable at the beginning and closing means opening and closing bills payables. So the company wants to measure how many times it paid its creditors over the fiscal year. So I already told you numerator means credit purchases. Net purchases means purchases. What is the purchases? 123,555 minus returns, purchase returns, 10,000. So net purchases will come here and by opening plus closing stock, opening and closing bills payable by 2. What is the opening and closing creditors or bills payable? 12,555 plus closing 12,25,121 by 2. So if you calculate this, 6.03 times means Therefore, over the fiscal year, the company accounts payable turnover is approximately 6.03 times. During this year, the turnover ratio would be likely to be rounded off if simply stated in a 6. So 6 times. So this is always like the creditors or payables turnover ratio. Higher the payable turnover ratio, the better the relation with the supplier, the better the raw material supply. So that's why this ratio always should be higher compared to previous year. This is another thing. And profitability ratios, then when we can check the profitability of the company also by you taking ratios. One is that what is the profitability ratio, what are the profitability ratios. So the profitability ratios are financial metrics. Financial metrics means measured, used by analysts and investors to measure and evaluate the ability of the company to generate the profit relative to revenue or balance sheet, assets, operating costs, shareholders' equity during the specific period of time. So in many ways, profitability can be checked. So that's why they show how well the company utilizes its assets to produce profits and value to its shareholders, how well they are doing this. So the higher the ratio or value is commonly sought after, means the higher the ratio is only majorly commonly a good company. It is that most of the companies is usually means that business is performing well, generating the revenues and cash flows. So that's why the higher the profit, the better the company, we can conclude by calculating these profitability ratios. And if you see this one more thing, net profit ratio. Under this profitability ratios, we can calculate the net profit ratio. What is the formula? This ratio indicates that firm's capacity to withstand the adverse economic conditions. A firm with a high net profit margin would be an advantageous position to survive in the face of falling selling prices, rising costs of production, declining the demand of the product. In these scenarios, even company is getting good profit, means its profitability of the company is good. So net profit ratio can be calculated like this: net profit by net sales, net profit by net sales. Out of your net sales, what is the portion of your profit? If sales is 100%, what is the net profit percentage? If you see this, if you calculate this ratio, you see the net profit. This is a net profit, it is a net sales, numerator, denominator. If you calculate a net profit by net sales, the net profit is continuously has been increasing from all the years. So it's a good sign. See, the graph is an upward trend. So the higher the profit, the better the company it is doing. It is good for the shareholders, it is good for the suppliers, and it is good for the employees. Even they will get the good salaries and good increments if company is earning a good profit. So profitability can be measured by taking this net profit and net sales in terms of ratio, a net profit ratio. So next one is that gross profit ratio. You know that one more way to calculate the profit is that gross margin. So gross margin tells you about the profitability of the goods and services, profitability of the goods and services, how effectively you are bringing and how effectively your direct expenses are used, and how effectively production takes place with less cost, more profit. So that's why it tells how much it costs you to produce a product, how much it costs. The higher the product cost, the lesser the gross margin. The lesser the cost of production, the more the gross margin. That is what the interpretation that we can say. That formula, we can say that gross profit by sales into 100. Gross profit by sales into 100. Gross profit, we can take sales plus closing stock minus opening stock, minus opening stock. This is OP means opening stock, minus purchases minus direct expenses. Sales plus closing stock. From these two, we have to deduct opening stock minus purchases minus direct expenses, which are incurred for making the product. So that's what the formula that we can calculate. And the gross margin, net sales, if you see there's a Tod's and Bob's, there are two companies. The gross margin is 25,000 and Bob's gross profit is 350,000. Net sales, if you see, 100,000 of Tod's and Bob's net sales is that 5 million. So like this, there is a gross profit margin is that even though net sales is less, but gross margin is more. Tod's company, even though sales is less, but their gross profit margin is more. Gross margin is more. But Bob's, even though their net sales is more, as well as their cost of goods sold, gross margin is less. Means their cost is very high. Cost is very high. Even though sales is more, but gross profit margin is only 7%. So sometimes, yeah, company may be doing less sales with less cost of production. So it leads to gross margin. So Tod's company is doing good in terms of net sales and gross margin ratio. And Bob's company, the gross margin ratio is very less. Means their cost of goods sold is more. So like this, we can do the interpretation for profitability ratios. So this is about ratio analysis. Now, fifth technique of financial statement analysis. Because first technique, horizontal analysis. So second technique, vertical analysis. Third technique, trend analysis. Fourth technique, ratio analysis. Now, fifth one is that funds flow and cash flow statement. Funds flow and cash flow statement. Here we are talking about funds flow statement. You know, funds flow, what does it mean by fund? A flow of fund means inward and outward movement of the fund of an enterprise. So there are some inflows of the fund, there are some outflows of the fund. So we can calculate this inflows and outflows of the fund by taking this technique. And for the purpose of the fund refers to working capital. Fund means here majorly we are talking about in funds flow, we are majorly talking about working capital. Our flow means movement or changes. How the fund is been changing, how the working capital is been changing from 1 year to another year, So like this, here the fund means majorly we are talking about working capital, how working capital is been changing. Because working capital is a major fund for managing your day-to-day expenses, to manage your stocks and bills and suppliers payment. So that's why funds flow, like working capital, is a major thing. That's why how this fund is been flowing, what are the inflow and outflow of the working capital fund. So that's why therefore a flow of fund means movement of changes in working capital. That is current items. Current items means current liabilities and current assets. Current assets, how they are moving. So based on that, whether the current assets, how many are moving, inflow and outflow, current liabilities, how, what are the inflow and outflow. So that, like that, we can calculate by using this fund flow statement. And I already told you, working capital means, funds flow means flow of fund of working capital. So funds flow, working capital can be calculated like this. Working capital is equals current assets minus current liabilities. Because it is a liquid assets. Current assets are the liquid assets. How quickly you are able to converting your current assets into cash and able to pay to current liabilities. So there must be equation. Already we have seen in ratio analysis, current ratio 2:1, two times of current assets you should have to pay one time current liability. So that firm flow of fund may be good. For a firm flow of fund may be good. So that's why that is what the interpretation that we can give by preparing this funds flow statement. So here there is a rule for preparing the funds flow statement. The following rule may be applied to current assets and current liabilities for preparing this statement. What is that? An increase in the current asset, increase in the working capital. Increase in the current asset. Then there is an increase in the asset, increase in working capital. When there is a decrease in current asset, decrease in working capital. Because we are using the formula, working capital is equal current assets minus current liabilities. That's why, is there any increase in the current assets, well, it leads to an increase in the working capital. Is there any decrease in the current assets? Like I already gave you the list of current assets and current liabilities, you have to find that. There is increase. So it is in opposite. Current liabilities, if we take an increase in the current liability, because when creditors have been increasing, automatically your current assets have been decreasing. When current assets have been decreasing, it leads to working capital decrease. So that's why increase in current liability, decrease in working capital. A decrease in current liability, decrease in you paid the creditors, that is current liability. So that current liability has been decreased, then your working capital has been increased. So like this, it is a reverse situation. This formula must be prepared. This formula must be followed while preparing the statement of changes in working capital, preparing that. So that's what cash flow statement. Cash flow statement, we can say that purely their working capital is having many components, but here cash means only cash components we take, only cash, not any other assets that we consider. So cash is one of the component of the current assets. So here in working capital, we are considering all the current assets, but in cash flow statement, we are considering only the cash, which is one of the component of the current asset. So cash flow statement is a statement which shows the sources of cash inflow and uses of cash outflow of the business concerned during the particular period, cash inflow and cash outflow of the business. So it is a statement which involves only short-term financial position of the business concern. So cash flow, cash means it's very short-term liquid fund. So that's why we are checking only short-term financial position of the business concern. So cash flow statement provides a summary of operating, investing, and financing cash flows. So cash flow statement provides a summary of operating. Operating means operating expenses, direct expenses, indirect expenses, and all those things will come. And investing means where you are investing. Investing means that due to investment in fixed assets, due to investment in projects, some cash may go and come. And due to financing activities means sometimes we may borrow money from the bank. That is financing activity. For that, every month we pay principal and interest. That is the outflow of the cash. So inflow and outflow of the cash is possible with the operating activities, that is direct and indirect expenses, and direct indirect revenues, that is inflow and outflow of the cash. Investment means buying a fixed asset, selling the fixed assets, and that is what inflow and outflow of the cash will take place in investment. And financing means borrowing the loans and repayment of loans, that is inflow and outflow of the cash. So operating, investing, and financing activities will lead to inflow and outflow of the cash. With these activities, how much inflow of the cash is coming, how much in outflow of the cash is going. So what is the net cash value? What is the net cash value? Like that, we can calculate the cash flow statement by preparing the cash flow statement, and we can know the cash flow position of the company by end of the year. It is not a mandatory, like most of the companies will prepare this cash flow statement. So you should know home assignment, you should know the fixed assets and current assets. What are the list of fixed assets and current assets? Fixed liabilities are the long-term liabilities and current liabilities. You should know the list. When you come for our next class, I will ask this question. You should come up with a list of current assets and fixed assets, list of long-term liabilities and current liabilities. You should remember this. And if you see the difference between cash flow and funds flow, if you see a glance, I already told you the meaning of funds flow and cash flow. A cash flow statement is a statement showing inflow and outflow of the cash equivalent over a period of time. I already told you it shows that. And funds flow statement is a statement showing the changes in financial position. Changes in financial position, an entity different time periods. Financial position means working capital, how it has been changing, current assets and current liabilities. So purpose of preparation, to show the reasons for movement in the cash and beginning and end of the accounting period. How much cash is coming in, how much cash is going out, and why. Because what are the reasons behind coming in the cash and going out the cash. And to show the reasons for the changes in the financial position with respect to the previous year and current year periods. Financial position, how fund has been moving, working capital is moving from one period to another period, what are the reasons. That is what the reason that we prepare funds flow statement. Basis, cash basis accounting. Here, accrual basis of accounting. Accrual basis of accounting means cash plus, as well as credit transactions also we considered for preparing this. Analysis, short-term analysis for cash planning. And this is a long-term analysis for financial planning. In long-term, how much fund we should maintain. So it is what a long-term financial position also which will show. And discloses inflow and outflow of the class. And sources and applications of the fund. Sources means inflow of the fund. Applications of means outflow of the fund. Operating and closing balances. Contains opening and closing balances of cash and cash equivalents. It includes the opening and closing cash balances. And it does not contain any opening and of cash and cash equivalents. It's just simply list of current assets and current liabilities and long-term fund sources we take that. Part of the financial statement. Yeah, cash flow statement is a part of the financial statement and funds flow statement is not part of the financial statement. That is what the difference between cash flow and funds flow statement. Cash flow and funds flow statement. And if you see this, with this, we have finished the financial statement analysis techniques. And if you see this financial planning is part of the second chapter. Every business unit, whether it is an industrial establishment or a trading concern or a construction company, needs fund for carrying on its objectives. They need a fund, but they need to have a plan for this funding. So it requires funds to acquire fixed assets like machines, equipment, furniture, etc. And to purchase raw materials or finished goods to pay to the creditors to meet the day-to-day expenses and so on. All these aspects requires fund. So finance is required. In fact, availability of adequate finance is one of the most important factor of the successful business. So to pay all these requirements, you need to have adequate finance, means enough money. So it is the most important factor of any successful business in this world. So however, the requirement of the finance nowadays is large, that no individual in a position to provide whole amount from the from his personal sources. So it is not enough one source of finance to get your financial requirement. There are many other sources of finance which you need to borrow from many alternatives to meet your requirements. So that's why, so the business has to depend upon other sources to use various ways to raise the necessary amount. So business has to depend on various sources to bring the finance to meet all these requirements. So that meaning of financial planning, if you see this, planning is a systematic way of deciding about doing the things in a proposal manner, purposeful manner. Why you are bringing the finance? What is the purpose? And when this approach is applied exclusively for financial matter, it is termed as a financial planning. What is the purpose of your finance? Why you are bringing? That is what you need to have a planning. After bringing, where do you spend? So you need to have a perfect planning, that is called financial planning. So thus financial planning involves estimating an amount of capital to be raised, how much capital is required for what you required, and how much you should be raised from the various sources, and determining the pattern of the finance, that is deciding on from the proportion of the capital to be raised, how much needs to be borrowed from the bank, how much needs to be borrowed required capital from the share capital, how much needs to be borrowed in the form of bonds. There are many financial sources. So you need to decide the pattern of the financing, from which source you should bring, and which is very less and cheap cost. Because if interest rate is high, again, it would be a burden to the company. That's why. So formulating the financial policies, procedures for procurement and allocating of affect utilization of the funds. This is what we required for planning of finance. So objectives of financial planning, objectives are determining the capital requirements, how much you required, and determining the capital structure. After deciding how much is required, with the capital structure, is it a debt portion or equity portion? Debt portion means you borrow from outside. Equity portion means you borrow through owner's equity, means issuing the shares. So it includes, already we have seen a capital structure, debt equity. So relative kind of proportion of capital structure is required. So this includes debt equity ratio. Debt means how much you are borrowing money for interest, how much you are borrowing money for in the form of shares to by paying the dividends, both short term and long term. Oh, so like this, you have to determine the capital structure after deciding the capital requirement. So you need to have forming the financial policies. So after borrowing, after bringing money from the share capital, after bringing the money from the debt holders or loans, then you need to have financial policies. Where do you spend? How do you spend with regards to cash control, lending and borrowing? So you are borrowing. So you have to work with that money to pay the interest, to pay the interest. That's why you need to have financial policies, framing policies, where to invest, how much returns to be get from that borrowed money to pay the interest, how much to be invested in effective revenues, generated projects. So like this, a financial manager ensures that scarce of financial resources are maximally utilized the best possible manner. So whatever the funds you are borrowing, that maximum utilization of the funds must be done to get a better returns to pay the interest to the debt holders and the payment to the debt dividend to the shareholders, so that you can, your objectives can be fulfilled if you use that borrowed and equity money in an effective manner. So financial planning process, if you see this financial planning process, then financial planning process is a logical of six procedures. What is that? Determine the current financial situation, how much you required, you fund, develop the financial goals. So you are trying to borrow the money for what purpose? What is your goal? Where to invest? Which project to invest? Financial goals must be, and identify the alternatives. Which one? Project one, project two, project three. Which one is better to invest? You have to invest a better alternative and evaluate the alternatives. Which project is better? Which is giving a less cost and maximum returns? Minimum cost, maximum returns, or minimum risk and maximum returns. You have to evaluate the alternatives and create and implement a financial action plan and reevaluate the action plan. After deciding which project is good, which project is giving a minimum risk and maximum return, and you find that project and you try to finish and invest your money. So that is what the financial planning is required. Thank you very much. With this, we have finished our second chapter. Then I already told you, select any company individual assignment. I already told you, select any company of finance and download any financial statement of any company and calculate vertical horizontal analysis with interpretation and comment on liquidity position of the companies by taking any balance sheet. These balance sheets are available online. You go to your Ethiopian company respective website and you can download your financial statement and you can submit by next week. Thank you. We'll meet in the next class. This will be uploaded in your YouTube. You can listen to this. Thank you so much for listening to this.